thanks to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is thy health and salvation. To His temple draw near, praise Him in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord who doth prosper thy work and defend. Surely His goodness and mercy here daily attend thee. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do. If with His love He befriend thee.
Just song. Ooh. Alrighty, everyone. Hey, we just want to welcome you guys in to Hill Country Church this morning. Welcome to the second weekend of Advent. Carol and I, the wonderful office manager here, we put up the trees this week and had some fun doing so. But also, I wanted to explain something I noticed in the years past. We've got four ornaments on the tree, and these are taken from our call to worship this morning. I wanted to read from Isaiah 9. And it says, starting in verse 2, the people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as the people rejoice at harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke and burden that burdens them. I think, there we go, sorry. For to us, verse 6, a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. So that's where those are from. I just want to say that this morning. Would you pray with me and we'll stand and worship? God, we just want to thank you for who you are, for you are good and you are merciful. Lord, as we, in our second weekend in Advent, turn towards you, turn our focus towards you, Lord, I pray that you would be with us, that you would work within our hearts, that instead of greed, Lord, that we find grace, Lord, work in our hearts just to seek you and your Son. Be with us this morning in the message shared as Pastor Rob delivers it in a while, and let us sing joyfully to you. Lord, we thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand and worship with us today?
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship your holy name. The sun up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. And bless the Lord, his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great, for all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. And bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and they're forevermore.
be seated.
Good morning, everyone. Before we have our scripture reading for the morning, I have good news. Well, yeah, it's good news. Sarah Dale is at the hospital right now, getting ready to have her baby. So, praise the Lord. Yeah, there you go, Grandpa. But the downside to that is the guy who usually runs all the cameras and gets all the production squared away is also at the hospital because he's the dad. So if you're watching this live stream, it'll seem a little different. Of course, it's still coming through and piping through. It just may seem a little different, so just heads up. Okay, let's read God's word together. So this morning, Mark chapter 1, starting in verse 1. In your pew Bible, it's on page 836. All right. In the ESV, the title of this little passage, it says, John the Baptist prepares the way. So here we go. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way? The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. John appeared, baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed in camel's hair, and he wore a leather belt around his waist and ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, after me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandal I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Let's stand with us as we sing, What Child Is This?
What child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet? Why lies he in such mean estate, where ox and ass are feeding? Good Christian, fear for sinners here, the silent word is pleading. This is Christ our King, whom shepherds guard and sing. Haste to bring him love, the babe, the Son of Mary. So bring him incense, gold and myrrh, come peasant king to own. The King of kings, salvation. Shepherds guard and angels sing.
The stars are brightly shining. It is the night of the dear Savior's birth. Long lay this world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. The thrill of hope our weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new on your knees. Oh, hear the angel voices. Oh, night divine. Oh, night when Christ was born.
Thank you. It's at this time that we, well, it's this time of year that we sing songs like that one, which is wonderful. reminding us of the Savior who has come into the world. And I was struck by some of the lines in that song, and especially where it talks about a weary world rejoicing when Christ came into it. And I would hope that that's my prayer for all of us, is that we would do the same this Christmas, is that we are weary. We're weary from a pandemic. We are weary from politics, from economic catastrophes and shutdowns and all kinds of stuff. But let us rejoice at the birth of our Savior, who we can look back in history and see he came. And he came for you and for me. And all this is true. It all really happened. And so we can rest in that, have confidence in our Savior Jesus, who continues to intercede for you and for me, pleading our case before God when we don't deserve any of it. But yet he does, because he is good and he is faithful and he is our King. So wonderful to think about that this time of year, and wonderful to think about what has brought us together. And that is, yes, the birth of Christ, the Savior coming into the world, God being made flesh and dwelling among us, but also this Savior growing up and dying for us, giving his life as a sacrifice for you and for me. It's quite humbling to think about when you think of Christmas in that way, is that's why he came, is to fulfill that role. And so, but it is what has brought us together. And so when we gather here every Sunday morning, we do communion. And it's a special time for our church family because we are sharing this meal together that Jesus has instructed us to. This is something that goes way back. This is something that's not new, something that all Christians have done since the beginning of the church. And so we are following in that tradition, as it were, coming in here and remembering the death of Christ as the sacrifice, as the payment for your sin, for my sin, for all of our sin. And we have to remind each other continually of that. So we do that. We do that every single Sunday. It's not just at Christmas. It's not just at Easter. Every Sunday, we come here and remember the gospel. We remember the good news of Jesus. Okay, but I also want to read to you something that was written a long time ago to the church in Corinth in the very first century, written by the Apostle Paul as he is instructing them on how to conduct their worship. This is what's great, is he could be writing to us too. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning in verse 23, he says this: "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" And in just a moment, we'll have the opportunity to do that. We will share in a time of communion together. But before we get to that point, I would love for you just to take what you have heard this morning so far. Ponder these truths. Christ is our salvation. His death means salvation for you and for me. Forgiveness, freedom, eternal life. All these things have been given to you. This is the greatest Christmas gift you will ever receive. And so it's time to remember that. Remember what he accomplished on the cross. But also, if there is a burden that you've been carrying around with you, this is also why he died. He wants to take away the burdens from you and rest in him. So this morning, I invite you to lay your burdens down at his feet. He will take them away from you. Whatever you're worried about, whatever concerns you this morning, lay them down at his feet. And if there's any unconfessed sin that's going on in your life, he will take that too. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So he invites you to do that as well. So I invite you to take a moment just where you're sitting in silence. Take this time of reflection and go to the Lord. And I will come back up here and lead us in communion in just a moment. Let me take this time to remind everybody here that here at Hill Country Church, we observe what we call an open communion, and all that means is you do not have to be a member of this particular church family to partake of this. So we invite all believers in the Lord Jesus to take part in this time. Okay, in the pew racks in front of you, you'll find one of these little cups filled with juice and a wafer on top. And if you want to go ahead and pull one of those out, if there's not one in front of you, they're all over the room. You can look in windowsills and on the back there. There's a table in the back. You'll find them. They're everywhere. And we're doing this so that we eliminate the risk of the virus spreading. So if you want to go ahead and peel back that top layer, we can begin and pull out the wafer. And of course, as we come into this time, we are remembering what Christ has instructed us. He instructed his disciples. He instructs us as well. And on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and he gave thanks and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So take and eat. And then if you peel back the other layer, in the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Take and drink. Would you pray with me? Father God, we come to you now and we are humbled by the sacrifice that you made by giving your son. We rejoice as we celebrate the birth, his birth into this world, Father. But we also celebrate and remember his death as the way of salvation for us. You have brought us back together with you, and we're forever thankful. There's nothing we can say or do to make up for it, Father, but it is by your grace, and we are so thankful for your son, Jesus. And thank you for this time that we are allowed to gather and remember his sacrifice. And so, Father, thank you for blessing our church in that way. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right, please stand with us. In Christ alone, our hope is found, no doubt. Some of my favorite verses in this song is in the last. It says, "Jesus commands our destiny." Thank God, no matter how often we stray off the path or whatever, in our day and our time is so relevant, is that no power of hell and no scheme of man can ever pluck us from his hand. Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, and my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love and what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. Our comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ we stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. the ground his body lay. Light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day. Up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to the final breath, Jesus commands our destiny. And no power of hell, no scheme of man could ever pluck us from his hand till he returns or calls us home. Here in the power of Christ I stand. No powers of hell, no scheme of man could ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls us home. Here in the power of Christ, let's stand.
Amen. You may be seated.
You'll see in your announcements there is a host of announcements. I'm only going to announce one of them this morning before we pray together as a congregation. Many of you received an email yesterday from Jerry Hominick. I also received some information from Larry Buckhorn. But Ernest E. Hobby is going to pack out a 40-foot Connex, a container, you know, the kind that you'd see on these giant ships. And currently in that container, there is a four-wheel drive Kubota tractor and front-end loader and a printing press and hospital beds and school supplies. So there's a lot of things in there already, and that's for Ernest to continue to get the school up off the ground in Cameroon and also other things regarding his ministry, which we heard about recently. But regardless, this 40-foot container is expensive to ship, whether it's half full or fully full. And so we as a congregation and our missions team have committed to being a part of what Ernest is doing, obviously. And so he's looking for stuff to fill the Connex or to fill the container. And so just a couple of things. And as I say these, if you feel called and led to donate these, that would be good. And of course, this is going to a cause to help further the gospel. And also, this is tax deductible at the end of the year. So things like farming equipment, big and small, construction material, big and small, roofing, plumbing, electrical, tools. And then inside stuff, computer, iPads, cell phones, office furniture, really anything you can think of, solar panels, if you have those laying around. They're also looking for some sort of large four-wheel drive vehicle or Suburban or something like that. So, of course, here at the end of the year, I know vehicles are donated and such. So if you have a vehicle that's just sitting around on the farm and not really doing anything and you think it could be beneficial to Ernest and his ministry, that would be good. And, of course, financial support. If you don't have a solar panel, but you have a check, you know, of course you could support in that way too. The point of contact for this is Jerry Hominick. His number's in your bulletin. And, you know, he's going to collect things here at the church, but he'll also obviously can coordinate other collections and et cetera. They plan to ship this by the end of December. So if you can and have the means to support Ernest in the Bread of Life ministry that he's doing, please do. You can see more, by the way, if you want to know more about his ministry, if you've never heard Ernest or haven't seen his website, breadoflife.org. And it's a very robust website that can share with you more about what they're up to in Cameroon, West Africa. Okay, let's pray together as a congregation. Let's go to the Lord. Father God, we come before you with hearts of gratitude. We remember the sacrifice that Jesus made on a cross for us that even gives us the ability to stand before your throne and go directly to you as Christ is our great high priest. And so right now we remember that. We thank you for that. We revere you for who you are as our Lord. And Father, we come in need. We have physical needs, things that challenge us and distract us and cause us harm and pain that could potentially prevent us from doing what we're called to do. And so, Lord, I pray for healing. I pray for restoration and strength. I specifically lift up our sister, Lauren Buckhorn, who is home from the hospital but is still fighting through and working through that. Lord, we pray for her and her healing and restoration. Lord, we pray for all of our friends and family and members and perhaps ourselves. Lord, please bring a peaceful and comfort hand that we may continue to do what you've called us to do. Also lift up Sarah Dale to you in the hospital, in the process of delivering their child. And Lord, I pray for safety, easy deliveries, healthy baby, healthy mom. Lord, I pray that you would intervene in that situation and bring the this gift of life to this world with no issues. Lord, I lift up our congregation. Of course, we're still fighting through the coronavirus, and so with the on the doorstep of the vaccination and cases rising, Lord, we're grateful and we praise you that you have healed our congregation, those who have received or not, those who have gotten the coronavirus. And Lord, I pray that this would end, that this virus would be eradicated, that this would stop. And Lord, I pray that you would intervene in that. For those that do have it, I pray for speedy recovery, full restoration of health. And Lord, I pray for our leaders, because this is not going away. It doesn't feel like this is going away. So I pray that you would give our leaders strength and wisdom and just the ability to make rational, well-thought-out, data-driven decisions that would allow this nation to continue to thrive and flourish. And Lord, I pray for unity in the body. A lot of things going on with the coronavirus tend to be fairly polarizing. And Lord, I pray that we as your people would have faith and we would trust in you and not the things of this world, that we would please you in that. Lord, I pray that we would love. You call us to love. I pray that we love each other. I pray we love the people that we work with, the people that we interact with. I pray that we would demonstrate through this weird time that we would demonstrate your love as you've called us to do. And Lord, I pray lastly for an effective ministry. We all have a ministry. You have called each one of us, every single one of us, to live a life pleasing to you, worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So Lord, I pray that you would give us strength. I pray that you would give us wisdom. I pray that you would give us boldness, that we may interact with our family and our friends and our coworkers and people that we don't know. And we would do what you've called us to do, which is to be a light, to be salt. Pray that you'd give us strength, encourage us in this endeavor. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pete. It was a great lead-in to this message today. And I want to begin by saying thank you for those of you that were praying for me and my family. I'm very thankful that I just had a very mild case of COVID-19. Couldn't be happier about that fact. But I was advised to stay on the shelf for a couple weeks, so I hadn't been here the last couple weeks. Thank you, Pete and Michael, for filling in for me. They did great. Wonderful. Word of the Lord, word from the Lord from those guys. So very thankful for that. And anyway, if you have your Bible with you this morning, I invite you to open with me to 1 John. We are back in 1 John. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 is exactly where we'll be. We're finally getting back to the basics. That's the title of our series in 1 John. It's been a while, I know. It's probably been a month or more that I've actually wanted to give this message for quite some time now over these verses that we're going to talk about today, verses 7 through 12. However, the time of year being what it is, this passage actually takes on new meaning. I've been wanting to get to it because it's all about love. We love that word, love. But this is all about love, and we need love right now. The world needs love. With all the craziness in the world, all the fear and uncertainty, and all the things that certainly don't look like and don't remind us of love, we need this passage today. We need to hear what the Lord has to say about love, but since we are getting close to Christmas, we also need to see the Christmas gift that is so clearly presented here. Yes, this passage is about love, but it's also about a gift and what we're supposed to do with that gift. Now, gifts are interesting. I have a love-hate relationship with gifts. I don't see myself as a good gift giver. Don't worry, I beat myself up about it all the time. You don't have to pile on if I'm not a good gift giver, but it's a thing, you know. Like if you're a gift giver, that's a gift in itself. There are people out there, you probably know them. My wife Michelle is one of those people. She is a gift giver. She loves giving gifts. She gets a lot of joy out of it, and she comes from a whole family of gift givers. So if you like to receive gifts, by the way, get to know Michelle. She's the one you want to know. But I'm not always a good gift receiver either. Just reminds me of what a bad gift giver I am. Don't get me wrong. I'm like you. I love it when I get somebody the perfect gift and then they love that gift. That really motivates me. But that's the problem. Because I overthink. I overthink it every time. I always want it to be the perfect gift, and so those are really hard to find. You know how hard that is. But I guess I just don't see the point in getting a so-so gift, a gift that is sort of appreciated or sort of valued. It makes it seem as if it's only given because it's expected. You know, it's Christmas. You've got to do that. You can't just skip the whole gift-giving thing. And I have this beautiful, selfless, gift-giving woman who I have to find a perfect gift for every single year. This happens every year. My track record, by the way, is spotty at best. Some years I do well, other years not so much. And I know what she says every time. She always says she loves what I get. Whatever it is, she loves it. But I can tell. I know. And I know I put way too much thought into this. My gift-giving stress level is probably at its peak about right now. As we get closer to December 25th, it will get worse until I actually get something. So I always feel like the pressure's on this time of year. And, you know, I can't get something practical for my wife, like a vacuum cleaner, because she'll think I'm dropping a hint that she doesn't clean enough or something like that, which is a message that's neither true nor a message I'd ever want to give to her. Speaking of practical gifts, I got to share this story with you. We had some friends back in Oregon. They were so great. We loved them dearly. Sweet family. They lived right behind us. They were extremely practical, very frugal people. But they're both like that, so it worked out. You know, they had a great marriage. It worked out well. And I actually learned a lot from them. But one year, the husband crossed the line. He bought his wife a toilet seat for Christmas. She had been complaining about the state of their old one, and she had been wanting a new one, and my friend mistakenly thought it would be a great idea to give her one for Christmas. Somehow his good judgment got clouded by doing something so practical that he actually went into Home Depot or wherever, and he came out with a toilet seat for his wife for Christmas. just knowing that guy and knowing that story makes me feel so much better. But it's a cautionary tale for people like me not to buy something too practical. Can't go down that road. I don't like buying clothes because I never know what size to get. Getting the wrong size could end in disaster. That's how I look at things. Perhaps worse, I could get her something that she doesn't like, something that's really ugly. I've done that before. I can tell you about dresses. I could show you dresses that collect dust in our closet, so I know that's true. So clothes are hard. Jewelry's hard. Gadgets are out. Michelle's not a gadget person. Something Christian? Nah, that's too cliche, right? Pastor gets his wife a Christian book or CD. Do they even sell CDs anymore? I don't even know. Something like that. As you can tell, the irony of my poor gift giving is that I put too much thought into it. Way too much. Whatever I wind up getting, I still worry it's not the right thing. No matter who it is, it's not just my wife, it's with anyone. So I tend to go through all kinds of negative thinking and end up with the most lame, yet the most loved gift of all, the gift card. They represent surrender, you know that, right? But truth be told, they are coveted. They are coveted. They are wanted. Much more so than a t-shirt or shirt that doesn't fit or is hideous. Just have to pick the right card. That's the only problem. Seriously, we put a lot of thought into Christmas gifts. Even though I stress over it, I still go out and I get my wife something every year. Even when we decide not to buy each other anything for Christmas. Have you ever done that before? She breaks that rule too, by the way. But I do it because I love her. I know this is the love language that she speaks. But I don't do it because it's expected. But because I want her to know that I'm thinking about her and she's special to me. And a gift can show that, at least in part. She knows because she knows how much I dislike the whole process. So when I buy her a gift, it's very special to her. But it's this time of year when most, if not all of us, are looking for the perfect gift. We put pressure on ourselves to find something great for that person or those people that we love, probably all for the best of reasons, too. Although I suppose there are some who are just trying to meet some unrealistic expectation on the other end. Then giving becomes compulsory, it becomes forced, and it becomes something we do in order to get something. I think many of us live our Christian lives in the same way. We look at our relationship with God like we've got to give him what he wants or he's going to be mad. And then we go to our Bibles and we look at it with those critical eyes as well. We start to obsess over trying to do something to earn our salvation. Some people feel like they need to perform in order to be accepted, to be loved. Our passage today will speak to this issue. It's going to reveal to us something about our giving and loving and receiving and responding. For it's not about us proving our love for God or for others. It's about God proving his love for us and our response to that. This passage teaches us that, yes, we are called to do something. We are called to give a gift, so to speak. But we are also given the greatest gift ever, by one who loves us perfectly. And because of that, we can then go love others, to give them the perfect gift, the one they need the most. Okay, so let's take a look at what it says, beginning in 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. Let me read these first two verses for you, or you can join me as I read this. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. I want you to see here that this is the call. The call is to give a gift, to make a sacrifice. That's kind of what giving a gift is, to demonstrate love. John has addressed his readers, as we've gone through this book, you've noticed, he's addressed them as little children and beloved, okay? Here he uses the term beloved, and it's fitting that he does so because that's the point he's making. He's not just saying that he loves us, or he, as in John, loved his readers, but that we are loved by God. We are loved by God. We are beloved of God, just like we are children of God. They're one and the same. He's saying, hey, you, reader, you who are loved by God, listen to what I have to say. And what does he have to say? Let us love one another. Again, this theme has been all throughout this book, but it's a gift request. It is a request for a gift. Someone who is obsessed with performance and trying to win somebody over, in this case, God, looks at passages like these and they see a commandment that must be followed. We are to love one another, and so they set off trying to do that. Now, there's nothing really wrong with that. And yes, we are commanded to love one another. John makes that point again over and over and over in this book. But we are not to love in order to earn something like God's love. Instead, we are to love because we are loved by God. We are the beloved of God. He already loves us. I talked about this several weeks ago, but the Greeks had lots of words for love. And as you know, the New Testament was written in Greek. And so we're borrowing from this language and learning. We have to learn some things about the language to know what it actually says in English. But the Greeks didn't just have one word for love. They had several. Words like phileo, which is brotherly love, like Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. Okay, there's that one. There's eros, which is romantic or intimate or sexual love. Storge, that's family love, like a parent would have for a child, perhaps. And then there is agape love, or the kind of love that God has. This is an unconditional love, and a love that expects nothing in return. It is a willingness to love even when there's nothing in it for you. That there is no gift given in return. In other words, all of the uses of love in this passage are the agape type love. So if we're encouraged to love one another, it's not just about appeasing others in order to get something in return to make them like us. No, it's giving without the thought of getting. It's not transactional. And surprisingly, God's love is not transactional. We don't love him so that he will in return love us. And he doesn't love us so that we will in turn love him and give him gifts that he somehow needs, as if he's dependent on them. No, his love is totally different. His love is totally different than what most of us are used to experiencing in this world. For it is foreign to this world, this type of love. It's just as John says, love, that is agape love, is from God, as it says in our passage today. It is unique to him. So whoever loves in this way, loves one another in this sacrificial way, has been born of God and knows God. It can be no other way. Now, this is not to say that non-Christians are not capable of loving unconditionally. Quite the contrary. Yes, they can. But this type of love that we're talking about here, this type of love should mark the Christian and the Christian community. It's what we should be known for, because it's what our Father is. It's who he is. It's unique. It's countercultural. It's unexpected to the world. The world teaches us to love ourselves and love those who we like and love those who are deserving of love. And it teaches us stuff like investing with love will get you love in return. Giving good gifts will get you good gifts in return. That's the thought. But God's love, which we have and characterizes him and should characterize us, is not just something that he has, it's something that he is. It says at the end of verse 2 that God is love. It's not all he is, but it certainly describes him well. Think of God as being like the sun. The sun is light, right? The sun is light, overwhelming light. Light radiates from it, and it goes out, and it affects us. It gives us light, and we are millions of miles away from it. The sun is much more than light, however. And of course, it's more than light, but you get the idea. We could call it light. The light goes forth. It is transformative. And its light shines on everyone. It brings light into the darkness. Same with God's love. God's love goes forth to everyone. It is also transformative. It goes even into the darkest places and into the darkest hearts. Exposes them. But then the question becomes, how do we respond to it? It's there, but how do we respond to it? It's our response to God's love that is so much more important than our will to love others with something that we can muster up in ourselves. We are called to love one another, and that sounds just wonderful. We like saying that. We like hearing that. But do you know how hard that is? Do you know how hard that is? Do you know how hard people are to love? Difficult people. People who don't agree with us. People who are mean. People who can't give us anything in return. People who don't want to give us anything in return. People who don't love us. John's talking about people in the church here, by the way. At least in this context, he's talking about people in the church, not the unbelieving masses. It's hard enough to love those who we count as brothers and sisters in Christ, much less all those that we consider our enemies that are out there somewhere. According to Jesus, we're to love them as well. So we must understand this concept of agape love. That's how we're to love others. It's like being asked to buy the perfect gift for that person you really dislike or who really dislikes you. It's relatively easy to buy a gift for someone you love or even like. But what if we're called to buy an expensive gift, one that's going to really hit your wallet hard, an expensive gift for someone you can't stand? It's not exactly like that, of course. But I'm trying to make a point as we go forward, because God did just that for us. He gave us the perfect gift, a very expensive and very valuable gift, a sacrificial gift to a bunch of people that didn't even like him. Let's take a look at that perfect gift, which is described in the next couple of verses, beginning in verse 9. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. I know that at Christmas, we usually read the Christmas story, what we consider the Christmas story, the Nativity, Luke 2, all that stuff. And that's proper. We should, for that's where what we are celebrating. That's the part of the Bible we go to when the baby Jesus is born in Bethlehem. But I want you to know that I see this, what we just read, those two verses, this is the Christmas story. We all know that Christmas is not really about the gift giving and the commercialism and all that stuff, but it is about the greatest gift. It is about the greatest gift any of us has ever received. That would be Jesus. When Jesus came into the world, it was the greatest gift ever because it was the gift of love. It was the gift of love. It didn't just show us love. It was love itself. Agape, love. And we learned in verse 2 that God is love. Therefore, God coming to us, becoming flesh, and dwelling among us, Emmanuel, is the gift of love. Look at verse 9. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might have life through him. Talk about the perfect Christmas gift. This is it. When we think about the baby in the manger in Bethlehem, we must see it as a gift like no other. a sacrificial gift of love, the gift of God Himself. And we must allow it to inform our thinking about God. Some people have a misunderstanding about God the Father. They see Him as they would see possibly an earthly father, perhaps even their own earthly father, who is overbearing and demanding and downright mean if you don't obey or comply or show respect. But we know from Scripture things like, God shows His love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That's Romans 5:8. That sacrifice was born into the world at a particular time in a particular place to demonstrate this amazing love. Even when we didn't deserve it. Nobody in the world deserved it. And that's where we're all so wrong. We think of God like Santa Claus. He'll give us the good gifts if we behave. You know, He's making a list and checking it twice, right? He's going to find out who's naughty and nice. But according to verse 10, in this is love. And again, this is agape love, the love of God. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son. Note how valuable the gift is. He didn't just send someone. He sent His only Son. You know that everything the Father is, the Son is also? Jesus is literally God in the flesh. So when you think about the value of this gift, it doesn't get any more valuable. God gave Himself for us. It was the ultimate sacrifice. Not that we deserved it or we earned it, but because of His great love. And again, it's like the Son. This gift is overwhelming. So much love was poured out through Jesus, through the birth of Jesus and His life, given so that we might have life, so that we might live, and we might love by Him in His power. At Christmas, it's as if the light of the Son shone into the dark world, and the light was for us, that we might live by it, that we might live in it, and that we might have that light inside of us as well. That's the gift that was given. The Father sent His Son to be, big theological word, the propitiation for our sins. Now, what does that mean? God is gracious, and God is love, but He's also just. We don't just get away with our sins. He doesn't just look the other way as if He didn't see anything. He doesn't just sweep it under the rug and forgets all about the bad things that we've done and all the times we didn't care about Him or His law or His standards. That's not how He works. That would not be just. Atonement has to be made for sin. That's what makes the sacrifice of Christ even more valuable and more unbelievable. Propitiation is agape love on display. Jesus was given as a sacrificial gift, a sacrifice that turns away the wrath of God, which is justified. It should be on us, on sinners who could care less about Him. We should all be rightfully punished for living without regard for God. Even if we didn't know it, we are all rebels. We are all enemies of Him just by nature, by our fallen nature. But that's what the cross is all about. And that is the good news. The death of Jesus is the turning of God's wrath away from us and on to Him. God sent His only Son to take that. This is what's amazing. Our minds can't even grasp that kind of radical love. That the God of the universe would sacrifice His only Son for the lives of really terrible people, quite frankly. Some of whom are openly hostile to Him. This is the greatest Christmas gift by far. And nothing else even comes close. I'll let James Montgomery Boyce explain how great this gift is. Listen to this. If God had merely sent Jesus to teach us about himself, that would have been wonderful enough. It would have been far more than we deserved. If God had sent Jesus simply to be our example, that would have been good too and would have had some value. But the wonderful thing is that God did not stop with these, but rather sent his Son, not merely to teach or to be our example, but to die the death of a felon that he might save us from our sin. So we might think, when we read stuff like this and we are humbled by the gift that we've been given, we might think that we need to find the perfect gift for God to repay him. Or perhaps to find it for others, to repay God through that. You know, to pay God back, to win his favor, to earn it. But that's putting quite a burden on us, one that we can't possibly handle. There is nothing we can do to earn this. There is nothing we can do to pay God back. Think about how silly that is. There is nothing we can do to make him love us more. We need to simply receive the gift, and then the gift is given for a reason. Receive the gift and allow the gift to transform us. That gift is love. Look at the last two verses, beginning in verse 11. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us and his love is perfected in us. I'm hoping as we read this, you see that we are to be a conduit, like a pipe, where God's love flows in, and in turn, it flows out from us to others. It's not about us digging down deep in our own selves. It's about allowing his love then to flow through us. Jesus, or John says, if God so loved us, we ought to love one another. This is how it should work. Not loving to earn favor, not loving to get something in return, not loving to gain the love of someone else, but simply allowing God's love to flow through us. He has given us an incredible gift. So when I talked before about how hard it is to love people, we must understand it's not our love that we are spending. It's God's love. It's God's love that is overflowing from us. And it's us allowing it to spill out onto other people. It's about not being able to contain God's love. Again, God's love is kind of like sunlight. We can't receive the sunlight and then trap it, box it up, keep it for ourselves. We must reflect the sunlight. That's what we do. In the same way, we are to reflect God's love. His love is perfected when we do this. It is maximized. It's how things are supposed to be. The last verse says that no one has ever seen God. And what he means is that no one has ever seen God the Father. Of course, people saw Jesus, and we know Jesus is God. He's the second person of the Trinity. We all know that, right? But God the Father is spirit. So what it means is that no one has ever seen God the Father. So how does he make himself known? How would one go about seeing God? How does he show his love, demonstrate his love? If he is love, how do we see it? He does it through his children. God cannot be seen, but we can. People see us, therefore they will know of God and of God's love when we love. Again, agape love, not one of the other kinds. If we love one another, it says that God abides in us. He remains in us. People should see Jesus in us. Not only that, but if we love one another, if we stop trying to find the perfect gift for God and the perfect gift for other people, and we instead allow God to love others through us, then his love is perfected in us. It is completed in us. It is the perfect gift that we need to give this Christmas. You see, people need love. You look around, you see it. It's all over the place. People in the church, people outside the church, everybody needs love. They need real love. They don't need another sweater. They don't need another gift card. They need real love. They may not appreciate it. They may not act like they want it. They may not deserve it. They probably don't deserve it. But that's the whole point. We love them anyway because we let love flow through us. And this love, this perfect love, is given in response to the perfect gift. So if you're wondering what to get someone for Christmas this year, go ahead and buy them that new toaster or iPhone or gift basket, whatever you are going to get. But more than any of that, make sure you give them love. Treat everyone the way God treated you, with grace upon grace. It's like the song says, what the world needs now is love, sweet love. If we call ourselves Christians, then we have it to give. You've been given the perfect gift. Just don't receive it for yourself. Give it away. This gift is love. Use it. Use it. So I encourage you to give love this Christmas so that God's love may be perfected in you. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the Christmas gift of your Son. As love entered into the world like the world had never seen before. Father, let us rejoice in that this year. As we mark another Christmas, let us not forget the gift that we have been given. And Father, let us not go out and try to prove something, but let us just respond to the gift that we've been given. Let us use the gift that we've been given. Let us enjoy it. And let your love be perfected in our lives, completed in our lives. Let us experience that. Father, we thank you. We're humbled by what you've done. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Well, Duncan had a conflict this morning, so he's not here to sing the doxology. But as he would say, if you'll stand and sing with great gusto, the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Have a great Sunday, guys. Mr. Pete.
All right. Good news, everybody. Listen to these words from Luke chapter 2. It says, and the angel said to them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Amen. You guys have a great week.
To the Lord. soul praise him, for he is thy health and salvation. All ye who hear, now to his temple draw near. Praise him. Praise to the Lord who doth prosper thy work and defend thee. Surely his goodness and mercy here daily attend thee. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do. Love he be to the Lord, oh let all that is in me adore him. All that hath life and breath, come now with praises before him. Let the amen sound from his people.